to, I have to familiarize you with the housekeeping rules here. So we have approximately 50 minutes ahead of us. And you can ask questions to our two lecturers. And I would be most happy if we can have equal amount of questions or joint questions to the two lecturers. 4:55, I will stop the questions and I will give the word for a final conclusive remark to our two lecturers. So questions, please. Yes, Helga, yes.
I wanted to ask a question to Stefan. So first of all, I'm very glad that you mentioned Joseph Schumpeter and this very important concept of creative destruction. We hear so much about disruption, and it always, for me, it was such a poor concept compared to the richness that creative destruction in the Schumpeterian things conveys. So thank you, and I think this is it's important when we think about innovation. My question to you is, are you speaking about two different types of evolution? In other words, is there a difference that you see natural evolution, which has a different time scale, where new rules may come up, but you know we cannot influence them or not much, perhaps with CRISPR and you know deliberate mutations, we can play around with it. But to compare this with evolution where we can change the rules, for instance, with your trade data, it's obviously there's the World Trade Organization, and it can say from one day to another, you know, we now have certain rules and certain standards, which will affect the way how you trade. You have a division of labor that is influenced also by political constraints, etc. In other words, the way how I see this cultural social evolution is that we have much more control over changing the rules, which in nature we don't, or to a much lesser degree. So my question is really, are you speaking about one evolution, or are you trying to say, well, there are two different types, and maybe, you know, in the future we will see it's one after all, but we are not there as yet.
I think, does it work? Yeah. I think you're perfectly right with your observation that in the context of social systems, we are in principle able to change rules and to influence rules, which in biology we cannot. But at least this is our take on it. There's only one model. Whether you have some control of the underlying combination networks is another story. But once you know how you can influence that, you can also model that by then externally changing these rules as evolution takes place. This is, in fact, what we are often doing in agent-based simulations. And we are running a specific scenario, and the scenario means change the rule a little bit and see what comes out. But for biological systems, it should, in principle, be the same model. So, for example, what is the two things that can be combined in biology? It's the father, it's the mother in sexual combination, and the kid comes out of it. Or it's a gamma ray and a DNA molecule, and what comes out is a mutation. It's a very, very flexible tool, which does not make any sense as long as you don't really specify what these dots and rules mean. But this was maybe the most important message. The details do not matter much for the statistics of the system, of the outcome, of the statistical outcome. And the statistical outcome is these distributions that I showed, distributions of lifetimes of these restructuring periods distributions of occurrence times, distributions of amplitudes.
Questions? Please, go ahead.
Thank you. So, hi. My question is also for Stefan.
Can you please identify yourself?
Yeah, so my name is Ajay. I'm from Yale and US College. That was a fascinating talk to, my question is to Stefan right now. View which you presented, first of all, it's very new to me, so it is really exciting to see it. My question is that one aspect which seems to, you know, bind your, the way the simulation worked and how you showed it, is the this new things as they had to come in at some frequency. And you kind of brushed it aside as to where, what's the source of this new things, because if we think about biology, the new things are kind of a, you know, it's an unusual thing to happen, right? So that is a general question. And one more point about more specific thing is like, when you're looking at World Trade data, for example, would you be able to distinguish the source of the product versus where it gets manufactured now, for example, and does that make any difference to your the way you plot it? The source which is selling the product versus where it is getting manufactured. For example, some countries now would outsource the product manufacture.
So for the first question, where do completely new things come from? Depends strongly on the context. So I don't know what would be an example. So fire, for example, the invention of fire is maybe a new thing that happens at some point in the history of mankind. Of course, it was a combination of a lightning stroke and a piece of wood, but as a concept that you could cook the, mammals with it is maybe something that comes from the blue sky, or that comes out of nothing. Don't take it too seriously that it has to come out completely from the external world or from outside the system. It can be a fluctuation of some kind. In particle physics, it would be a fluctuation.
But if it already exists from the way you were describing, then, you know, it will go into a static state. That's your description, right? That if new things in some way already exist in some form, then eventually it would result in a, you know,
so okay, that's
extended equilibrium.
I see your problem. It's a good observation. You're saying if I'm not bringing it from the outside, I would have to assume that we are always going to stasis. No, it just has to be new relative to what is going on in the system. That's maybe.
I mean, this reminds me of serendipity, which is very widespread in every research process. You come across things that you have not been looking for, but you recognize the importance. And this is something new that, you know, research lives off, so to say. And so I don't think we have to wait for something to fall from the sky. It's there, but you have to recognize it. So it presupposes what you call skills. You have to have a certain training. You have to be also lucky, because there were very clever people who saw something and they did not recognize the scientific significance. And then, you know, another research team came and said, wow, you know, this is high temperature superconducting in this context. So I think that. But Stefan, if I may, there is one book of a historian of technology, Edgerton is his name, with the name of The Shock of the Old. And he shows how much we rely in our technological, you know, everyday life, but also whole industries on technology that was already there before. So in your view, are these, it's recombination, as you said, but are these old technologies, have they been destroyed? Are they in a limbo? What is the status? You know, they live on because they are being recombined with something else. And when you speak about, you know, the destruction and they are pushed aside, what is the status? Is there a third status, so to say, in the picture that you are drawing, or do we have to say either or?
Oh, very good point. In biology, if we lose a species, the species is gone. It's out. But in the economy, in the economy, if we are inventing the memo stick and the MP3, the magnetic tapes are out from every practical purpose in on the markets, but they're still there. We could fall back on them within very short time. There's still places where you can buy magnetic tapes. I don't know for what reason, for historic reasons, but you can find them. So there, you would call it limbo. And these were things we tried with these model modifications, if that matters or not. This was one of the items.
Yes, please. Go ahead. Identify yourself, please.
Hi, my name is Seng Kai Wong. I work for A*STAR. I would like to pose this question to both speakers. Professor Stephen Hawking has been quite vocal lately regarding the threat of AI on the future of humanity. I would like to know, viewing from the lens of your own expertise, do you share his pessimism and why?
Okay. all these, I would call them reflexive speculations. Reflexive in the sense that there is a real concern that something terrible could happen, but it's a speculation because we don't know. It could happen. And this is my answer, it could happen. But at the same time, we are, because we have been dealing with this uncertain future throughout our history, at the same time, we realize that sometimes we can do something to prevent a risk or a danger actually to happen. And so I would interpret this remark as, or his opinion, as something that is a kind of wake-up call. You know, let's look what could happen. Let's become aware of the dangers that are connected with the development of AIs if they become completely detached from our, you know, value system and norm system, and finally we relinquish control. On the other hand, you know, experience teaches us that there are still many imperfections. We are not there as yet. Recently, there was in Vienna, there was Michael Jordan, who spoke about statistical and he called it computational and inferential thinking. And he showed how far the computer people and the statisticians are apart and what is needed, you know, to get us there. And there are many other areas where you could point this out. But I think in the end, it's my personal view on this, in the end, I think we are in a kind of arms race with the machines that we are producing. And are we clever enough to work with clever machines to do clever things that we cannot do? Or are we, you know, taking a backseat and saying, well, we have no control except to let things go on. So that's how I see it.
So I would not be concerned with artificial intelligence in the sense of machine learning will take over soon or will be a threat. It works fantastically for speech recognition, for pattern recognition. It works perfect for the things it was designed for. But speech is not... Speech is an evolutionary... Language is an evolutionary thing, but it's extremely slow. So that's why artificial intelligence works well on it. It does not work well for every process that's truly evolutionary and fast. Why? Because it has never learned it. It cannot anticipate it. Machine learning can extrapolate, but not learn how a complicated or a complex system is running. It simply cannot do that. Peter Sloat once told me his view on this. It's a little bit technical, but if you have processes which do not converge to anything, which do not have a mean or a variance or something, and many processes are of this kind, a machine can never learn these things, by definition, cannot learn it. So I'm not concerned with machines taking over in that respect. On the other hand, I think we are already lost. We have built an artificial intelligence machine that's called Google, for example, and we are completely caught in it. This is, we're using it as a device that gives us answers to our questions, to basically every question we can pose. We're not asking our religious leaders anymore. We're not asking our wives anymore. We're asking Google. It's the source of truth for us. And in this way, the machine reshapes completely our way of thinking and of our concept of what is reality, etc. And we have lost in the sense that where is the turn-off button for Google? It is not there. We are not under control of this machine any longer. So this is just an example where I think that we have already lost. In the sense of machine learning, I'm not concerned.
Please, go ahead.
Back from NTU. Professor Nowotny spoke about uncertainty, especially in the field of social sciences. Actually, my question to Professor Thurner would be, can these uncertainties be quantified inside the evolutionary models that you have described earlier on?
I think, speaking for the present, I don't think we are there yet, but I have the hope that the next era will be the age of social sciences, where we get better and better in understanding these uncertainties, how they amplify each other, how they when they go viral, shape environments that then form new social rules and norms. That would be the aim, or one of the aims. But I think right now, except for some examples, we're not there. Helga, what is your view?
Well, I would just underline the message. We need more social science knowledge, but in a way that is amenable to be quantified without taking a sledgehammer, you know, and making a parody out of social science knowledge, which is what very often happens now. And you do a disfavor to both sides because you end up with something that is much poorer or even a parody. There have been these engram works using historical data about China. And I forgot the specific area that was at stake. If the computer scientists had just taken the time to speak to a sinologist who knows about a particular era, whether it took the data, and then all of a sudden there was a gap of 20 or 30 years. They interpreted this as nothing happened. The sinologist would have told them this was an era of extreme famine. Everything broke down. Not even, you know, the court scribes could write down anything because it was a complete collapse of societal administrative functioning, you know. And it's these kind of discussions that have to take place. Go and speak to people who are knowledgeable in terms of be it history, be it psychology, be it whatever. And on the other hand, try to help them in a dialogue also to make quantifications that do justice to the richness of the data.
Can I just hook on this question and tell you, Helga, that actually until now in the series of these evolutionist lecture series, we always try to be, the lecturers try to quantify things, quantify in physical terms, in quantitative biological terms, even in, I would say, historic terms, major transitions in the history of human development, technology, Brian talked about it and so on. But you were really the very first lecturer who introduced in your lecture value systems and value judgments. You talked about humbleness and hubris. Humbleness, hubris, and other value system-based notions and terms. And now, I fully agree with you, you criticize those new sociological schools which try to put all these things into some kind of a quantifiable measure. So how can we see this evolutionary, let's say, spectrum so that at a certain point value systems should be used because they come into the play?
Okay. Before answering your question, let me go one step backwards in time. You know, when modern science came in the 17th century in Europe, started to take shape, people were very much worried, how can we produce empirical data? How can we make sure that we know that we understand what works and what does not work? And this was embedded in a social context. For instance, the Royal Society in London, one of the oldest academies, staged experiments that had been conducted by the members of the Royal Society in public. So you came to a theater like here, and you had a replication of the experiment that had been done in a shack somewhere else to demonstrate in public that it works. So you were looking for a social certification, confirmation that it worked. Now, what is interesting, this, in a sense, fitted into the time because it was like, I have to speak and show something in front of witnesses. So it needed the concept of a public witness. Otherwise, you know, it would be in the shack. So you need a concept of public witness. But then you need a criteria, who can be a public witness. So women were excluded, but not because they were women, or at least this was not the argument. The argument was, you can only be a public witness if you are economically independent. And women were economically dependent on their fathers or husbands. And if you're economically dependent, your judgment, this is one reply, your judgment is not as it should be. Yeah. So this is just one of the episodes. Then people were struggling enormously with how to come to grips with their subjective impressions, their senses. People did not trust their senses. You see things, but at the same time, you know, coming from medieval ages, can you really trust what you see? And so slowly, slowly, there's a history how in science the concept of objectivity emerged. And it was a continuous struggle. When photography came up, you know, at first it was hailed, now we have an objective tool. We make a photograph of what we see, and this is it. And then people discovered, you know, photographs, it depends how much light you have, what angle the photograph you take. Scientific experiments, I'm not speaking about anything else, but about scientific experiments. And you could show how unreliable this seemingly objective tool of making a photograph is. So you have to take the social context into account. And then we had this, you know, it's understandable, but it has historically grown. We have in many ways this separation. There is science and there is values. There are facts and there are values. And what we forget is science itself as a cultural, human, social activity depends on values. The value of scientific inquiry. If you don't have that, you know, you get something, but you don't get the kind of science that we want to have. And also, when I spoke about this Abraham Flexner manifesto, you know, I deliberately used the term belief. You know, you cannot prove it in advance, but you believe that you are right based on historical experience. But it's a belief, and it's a deep-seated belief that we all adhere to. So all this enters and interacts with science. But if you talk to social scientists, you know, we have to get into a kind of transition where I think we are moving away, and I think we are an interesting epistemic and transition in terms of the categories we are using. We are used, this has a lot to do with modernity, it has a lot to do with the way how we were thinking but also building a modern world, that you have very strict separations of categories. And you can define them, they are mutually exclusive, etc., etc. And now we are entering a period where we see much more of a blurring of boundaries, of categories. And just to quote Sidney Brenner again, we had the privilege of having dinner with him yesterday. You know, and at one point he was describing a situation where someone said, now you have to choose, it's either or. And Sidney Brenner said, and maybe both are wrong. You know, so if you are faced with two options, decide, is this correct or that correct, but only one can be correct. You know, his answer was a wise answer, a phronetic, going back to Aristotle, phronesis, a wise answer, both can be wrong. And I think this is an interesting epistemic transition where we are moving into.
Oh, there are questions. Yeah, because you have the microphone.
Okay.
You start and then.
Thank you. I'm economics, Yusin Kua from economics. Well, thank you for the two very excellent, fascinating talk. Actually, I'm beginning to feel very inadequate as an economist, given the very deep thinking provided by Professor Nowotny on the evolution and development of science. But I gained my composure after listening to Professor Thurner in linking evolution to transitions, including the economy. But very soon, I later become discomposed again when I looked at the very complicated models, and evolution is a sandpile and a self-critical and so on. My questions for Helga. One is that you mentioned a lot of uncertainties and also on the continued potential advancement of technology, which we might not be able to foresee or estimate with some degree of confidence. You mentioned von Neumann's 1955 article. If this is a scenario, then can we really fault or criticize coming down to earth President Bush when he did not readily agree on the US joining the multilateral treaties in a series of actions combating the climate change that curbs carbon emissions? President Bush at that time gave a speech where he posed the possibility of new advanced technology that may drastically solve our dilemma in years to come. Is he being just optimistic, or rather he knows that we tend to underestimate the development of technology? Is this oversimplistic in his argument, or just hubris? I just like the term that you introduced us just now. And for Stefan, I think your talk is, as I say, is quite complex, and its linkages to the economy, to networks, and the evolutionary process. Can you explain in one or two sentences how this, we know of the herd mentality, how does the herd mentality affect these complex models that you have? Thank you.
Should I start? So how could we think of herd mentality in the framework I showed? So again, we have to always make sense of these, what is a combination of two things. So it would be now two people, both with an opinion. You have an opinion, I have an opinion. After we meet, we come out with two new opinions. Maybe they are now the same because you were more influential than me, or more clever, or better in rhetorics. You have changed and updated my opinion, and that's a new state in the system. So and if this is happening collectively throughout the system, then you get something like a herd dynamics. It's if you simplify that system that I've shown you, you could think of every node in this network as a spin, as a magnetic thing that tries to align with the neighboring spins. And if the temperature is low enough, you will get a herding behavior, meaning that all the spins go in the same direction. So in this sense, this herding and clustering is all built in.
I would have given a more simpler interpretation. I would have thought in your model, you change the rule. Think like your neighbor, and then it's solved, and then you have hurting. But okay, to come back to your question about Trump withdrawing the U.S. from the Paris climate regime. You know, I speak about and think about the with a metaphor, one way of encountering and dealing with uncertainty. And the metaphor is the cunning. It's a metaphor. Cunning means uncertainty sometimes gets you into situations where at first you say, how terrible is it? And then you discover in this situation there are some aspects that you have not thought about, and some of them may turn out to be positive. Now, concretely, what is happening in the US is that you have, not on the federal level, but on the state level, you have states, it's not only California, it's a number of states, it's a number of cities that are taking this refusal by their president as a very strong incentive. Now we have to come up with the right kind of measures. So you have a reversal of the behavior that Trump probably had expected. And this is one of the instances where I would say, you know, you see the cunning of uncertainty at work.
Question over there, then Brian, and then there was a...
Okay, my name is Ho Seng Bing, I'm from A-Star. I'm an AI researcher, so this is just a comment. Actually, it's not to ask any specific questions to the speakers. So I'm always very irritated by people like Stephen Hawking, who's actually a physicist, and I respect him in his field, right? But he really doesn't understand, and in fact, many people who make comments about AI, they really don't understand what is possible. Now, I want to point out a similar situation in physics itself, right? Some years back, remember they were trying to ratchet up the energy of the Large Hadron Collider to try to discover the Higgs particle. And there are a lot of concern that, these physicists are going to create a black hole that will destroy the whole world, right? And I'm sure the physicists themselves are laughing at that. So this is just a general comment, yeah, this peril situation. And as Stephen Hawking is a physicist.
well, You know, with the CERN collider, this was the source is known. It was one British physicist, but the media jumped on it, and the media sometimes make the mistake. The media have their own rules, and in order to make it interesting for an audience, they think you have to show a controversy. So you invite one scientist who thinks this is right and the other one who thinks it is false or nonsense or bullshit or whatever you call it. And they think there is a parity, while in reality, you know, there are some freak scientists. They are probably in the range of 1% or less, and some fields there may be more. But there is a strong scientific consensus that this would never, I mean, this is so highly improbable, like, you know, having an asteroid that no one detects falling on CERN. But the way how it was played out in society, and then people said, well, you know, scientists say, and the one person becomes 50% according to the media. And this is also something that we need to make clear that this is not the case.
Richard Feynman once said, when he was speaking about scientists not talking about their field, that if they give you answers on subjects not about their specific field, they are as dumb as their neighbor.
Thank you.
Brian. Thank you. This is mainly a comment about Stefan's talk. I thought it was a really beautiful talk. What you were doing was showing an incredibly simple, what we would, by the way, my name's Brian Arthur, I should have mentioned that, NTU and Santa Fe Institute. What you were doing in our sort of parlance is creating a toy model, an incredibly simple one, and then you show that it's almost universal. It's like an archetype. It pops up all over the place, and it has this delicious dynamics of nothing much happening, then frenzies of activities, avalanches of changes, and then nothing much more. So it's beautiful work, and it's kind of classic Vienna Hub type work. You know, simple model, simulations, and an awful lot of insight. What I want to mention, and I don't mean this quite as criticism, but I think this would round out your work a lot more, the idea that that innovations or new technologies come from combinations wasn't at all new with Schumpeter. It was written about by a guy called Thurston. He wrote a book about steam engines in 1880, a couple of years before Schumpeter was born. I can give you all these references later. And that idea crops up again and again and again. Schumpeter, brilliant enough, probably cooked it up himself and didn't link it that much very directly with evolution, which is what you're talking about. So Schumpeter's one in a line of people who've thought of that. The idea that you can combine things and make that into an algorithm, that's evolutionary, new things appear, etc. That also has literature. 30 years ago in the Santa Fe Institute, there were several papers written, probably you cite them, I don't know, should have mentioned them, by Don Farmer, Walter Fontana, who's from Vienna, Stuart Kaufman, who's from just about everywhere, and maybe Stuart brought it into your jurisdiction, I don't know. They call this algorithmic chemistry. The idea is you could combine randomly in a computer model A, B, and K, and then you'd get something quite new. Gorgeous studies, beautiful work. I want to mention one other person, and that's William Fielding Ogburn, 1922, quite obscure sociologist. But just one quote from him is, the more there is to invent with, the more innovations we get. Essentially the same thing, but now directly linking this up with the whole network of what happens afterwards. And then also my own work, 2009, where there's explicitly a mechanism called combinatorial evolution, which works exactly as you're talking about. I think that what would be beautiful here, Stefan, is to set your work like a little jewel into a surrounding context. There's a lot has been done in this area. It's pretty obscure because this hasn't yet gone onto too many radar screens, but nevertheless, there's a lot of literature already.
Thank you, Brian, for the hints. I will ask you again for the Thurston thing. In our papers, we give proper credit to Farmer, Fontana, etc. And also, the work I showed you was from 2005 to 2007 mainly. And after 2009, the works include your work too.
Let me also comment on Brian. I think what you just said is a very good example of the combinatorics of ideas. Ideas that come up in different times, different people. You know, some are not taken up, but then rediscovered. And there is in the humanities, there is a field called history of ideas. And this has never been quantified, but it would be interesting, you know, to use the kind of modeling that you are doing now to apply it also to ideas and how different concepts come up and are combined. But just for the sake of accuracy, what Schumpeter did was, in addition to saying, you know, you can combine different technologies, he was also saying for innovation, it is important to look at the organization and to look at the modes of finance. And this brings back, you know, he was one of the first, I'm also a great fan of Schumpeter, not only Stefan. He was one of the first who realized the importance of modes of financing for innovation. And what Stefan just mentioned about Google, this is so important nowadays, and this is why I said, you know, we notice this shift from resources and labor to information and capital, finance. And Google has so much financial capital, they can buy up any research group, they can pay any young, bright graduate from wherever to work with them. And I think to understand the world we are living in, we also have to take this into account. And I see Schumpeter as one of the very early ones, because of his personal experience as finance minister, he was very much attuned to it. But he understood it, and you know, he wrote about this in 1911, so more than 100 years ago.
So we have time for one or two more questions, the final.
Yep. Hi, thanks for your talks. I am Ezekiel from the Singapore Center for Environmental Life Sciences Engineering, quite a long name. And the question about AI made me think on you answer saying that they are slow learners, but there are other guys that are very fast learners that are the microorganisms. And I wanted to ask for your comments on this, because now that we live in the Anthropocene, right, we have created a lot of special selection conditions for these organisms to evolve, and they do it very rapidly in a fast way that maybe we cannot predict yet. One example is the arise of antibiotic resistance. Since the last antibiotic was discovered last century, we are already seeing a lot of strains that are able to resist antibiotics. Or, for example, plastics biodegradation, there are starting to appear some strains that are able to degrade plastic and so forth. So I think it totally makes sense to try to understand how evolution works, because we are creating these conditions for these guys to evolve in ways that we are not able to predict yet. I work with wastewater treatment, and activated sludge is the most widely used process to treat sewage water in cities in the world. And it's only 100 years old. So these organisms have been evolving for 100 years only here, and they do it very fast. So in your model, there was it was described one aspect of E. coli, right? Could be able to be described in the model. So I just was wondering what were your thoughts on the guy, the role of these guys.
Sounds like a very challenging way to go. I would not immediately know how to start and how to think of ways of squeezing this into this framework I've shown you. I don't know. One would have to sit down and start thinking, I guess. Sorry for that stupid answer.
So I think we have to respect time. We have 5 more minutes. If there is one more final question, please go ahead, microphone, and then I would like to give the word to our speakers and finally.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Melissa from Royal College of Art from London. And my question is for both of you. And it was well known that some oil companies already knew about climate change, and scientists already knew about what their practices could derive on. And so what my question is, what is the role of the scientists if they are being economically dependent to those industries? And what do you think there's a way to end these harmful practices?
Yeah, I really think Helga could do a much better job.
No.
I'll try. Yeah, I think it's possible. In science, you always have this debate, right? And the matter of climate change was a very long debate over, I don't know, maybe 30, 40, 50 years?
Arrhenius already. Ah. You had already Gustav Arrhenius in Sweden who made important, he discovered climate change in a sense.
So you see Helga would be in much the, in better. The, so, and then there's times when evidence starts to build up on one side. And that was not until so long ago. And so even though it's now very clear to us, it's also clear that there's still the possibility for paid or for scientists who are not radically objective or who are not trying to be radically objective, that they come up with these denialist statements. And it's, how do you have to, how can I say? It's, maybe if you take all the statements of scientists, you get something like a Gaussian distribution on their opinion on if climate change is taking place or not. That Gaussian is now clearly shifted to the side where climate change really is happening, and that there's still people around who are denying it is just a consequence of the Gaussian plurality that we have.
Okay. Let me try the following way. If you compare the world we live in now with, be it the 19th or the 18th century, or even, you know, the Royal Society asking for independent witnesses, whatever happens in our world, science and technology are implicated in almost every political decisions. It has to do with safety standards of food. It has to do with the way how we regulate our traffic, diesel emissions, et cetera. Wherever you look, you have this much closer interaction and intertwining of what used to be political decisions and scientific technological content and substance. And this changes also the way how scientists are seen. They are drawn into controversies or into conflicts of interests, where many scientists say, well, you know, I want to do science, I want to do nothing, you know, that gets me into this hot spot where I have to decide where my interests are. So it's difficult for scientists today. On the other hand, this reliance, we need the scientific evidence, but it needs to be interpreted in context. And what happens in the US, in my reading, you know, in Europe, you hardly have, you know, the Gaussian contribution in Europe looks very different from the Gaussian distribution in the US. You have very few people who doubt climate change. You have very few people who ever thought creationism is even worthwhile discussing, while at the same time in the US you had these hot debates about creationism, etc. So, you know, it's the general political climate and the society you live in that also shapes these controversies and the discussions. But there are instances, and the most famous or infamous one is the way how the tobacco industry was deliberately buying scientists. There is no other word. It's a corruption of science that happened with the tobacco industry. This has been very well documented by now. And this, we hope, will not be repeated. And very often when you hear, you know, something is not accepted as scientific, ask a second time yourself, what are the economic interests behind it? And it's not so difficult to find them. But then you should speak about economic interests, which is a legitimate concern. I mean, firms want to make money, they want to make profit, but you should not come with this, you know, under the pretense it is unscientific. So science is being used partly as a weapon to discredit groups that you don't want to accept because it goes against your interest. And so welcome to this new world in which we live. It has some fantastic opportunities, but we also have to be alert and to sharpen our concepts and ask ourselves also which are the values. And I think for science is a way of organized skepticism, and it has served science extremely well to be a community of organized skeptics. And I think this is something that needs to be communicated to society and to policymakers alike, but let's stick with organized skepticism.
Thank you so much. Apologies if I have to close the discussion. If you have further questions, I hope Helga and Stefan can answer it either by email or you happen to ask them after this meeting, and if they have time, they can answer it. Before I give back the word to my sparring partner, friend, and co-organizer, Jan Fassbinder, let me ask the two speakers to summarize your take-home message after this afternoon for the audience in one minute. Helga, please.
My take-home message is the future is uncertain, but radically open for us to intervene.
And my statement is, we are ahead of a maybe very disruptive period if we don't get our homework done with getting into harmony with climate change and our relation with the environment. And what I think would be extremely interesting to find out also scientifically how and if we could change rules that we are not running into this transition in a way that I showed, but in a planned and a little bit continuous and plannable way.
Thank you so much. And now let me ask Jan to say a few words in order to...
Just sit down for about an hour, I'll start to summarize it a bit. No, I will not say very much, except that first to thank the two speakers. Please do so very loudly with a... Then thank the moderator, who did also a very good job. And then I'd like to remind you that the YouTube version of the video that have been taken will be online, I think, in about 10 days from now. So if you didn't understand all of it, you can look it up again and follow the whole conversation and both presentations again. It's under the Paralimes website, but if you go directly to YouTube and you fill in Paralimes, you'll find them also. So there's many ways to get to these videos. And finally, I would like to draw your attention to four historical videos that have just appeared on those on that website. There is four lectures by Sydney Brenner, who I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago, gave four lectures of 1.5 hour, two of which together with Terry Sinofsky, who is a leading neuroscientist from the United States. He gave four lectures on the history of microbiology, molecular biology, yes, the influence of molecular biology on neuroscience and about the big questions that need to be asked. You've seen Sydney, he is not in a very best shape that he ever was. These were unique lectures. They might not be repeated again. I would very strongly recommend, if you like these kind of things, to watch them and to tell other people that we have them. So having said that, on the 11th of December, we have a sort of an epilogue, which is the 11th on 10, so 11 on 10. So we will have one more session in December. I'm not quite sure where and what time, etc., but you can find that on our website, or Karen will, or the Evolution Club will let you know. And then we will finish this series, and we'll have to think of something else. We already thought of something else, but we'll let you know that in the next year. Okay, thank you very much.